Climate change and the road to net zero. Human prosperity and planet Earth. If the history of the Earth were condensed into one day, the story of human civilization would start just 0.2 seconds before midnight, or 12,000 years ago, as the planet emerged from the last ice age. At this moment in time, concentrations of CO2 in the atmosphere stabilized, and so the average temperature on Earth settled at a comfortable 14 degrees C. Humans built permanent settlements, supported by a newly dependable agricultural yield, thanks to the now stable climate. We domesticated animals, repurposed land for growing crops, and transformed the Earth's natural resources to support an ever-expanding human empire. Populations grew, but prosperity did not. Agricultural production slowly increased, but any gains were met with more mouths to feed. So, for most of human history, most humans have experienced the same levels of disease, hunger, and violence as all generations before them. That is, until 2 centuries ago, at 0.004 seconds before midnight, when along came the Industrial Revolution. This was the moment modern humans mastered combustion, just as Homo erectus had mastered fire. We unlocked millions of years of the sun's energy stored in fossil fuels and used it to power the machinery of the modern world. Both population and prosperity not only expanded for the first time, they exploded, and so did CO2. The number of humans on planet Earth has surged from 1 to nearly 8 billion people, yet the average income has ballooned from $1,000 to $18,000 per year. Life expectancy has doubled, child mortality and extreme poverty are 10 times lower, and deaths on the battlefield have declined 20-fold. We are living through a period of unprecedented wealth, quality of life, and relative peace. Yet, not everybody is on board. Half the population still has no basic sanitation, clean cooking, or electricity. Nearly 1 billion people have no access to safe water or sufficient food. Population and consumption will continue to grow, as developing countries rightfully strive for modern standards of living. So, unless we fundamentally change how our system is powered, CO2 emissions will also continue to climb, and even higher concentrations will accumulate in the atmosphere. The debate over the future of humanity has moved from the perils of an expanding population to the threat of carbon dioxide, rising temperatures, and the impacts of climate change. On one side of the dispute sit those who foresee a dystopian vision for the future should we not limit population, consumption, and emissions. On the other side of the quarrel sit those who remain convinced that human innovation, technology, and free markets can weather the coming storm. So, who is right? Are we stumbling headfirst into disaster, or striding towards even greater prosperity? Are we headed for doom or boom? Understanding our climate futures to empower action. Temperatures are already over 1 degree C higher than in pre-industrial times. Make no further change to our global system and we will warm the planet by at least 3 degrees C by the end of this century and by 4.5 degrees C by the middle of the next. Sea levels will rise and the ocean will become increasingly acidic. Amplifying feedback mechanisms such as melting tundra or burning forests may accelerate change even faster. We are already experiencing 3 times the number of climate-related natural catastrophes compared to 40 years ago. The last 20 years have recorded 19 of the hottest in the last 2 millennia, and with half of the strongest hurricanes on record. If we don't change the way we fuel the economy, over the next 80 years, more than 1/3 of the global population will lack sufficient clean water and nutrition. And 500 million more could be forced to migrate due to extreme heat and rising seas. The air pollution from burning fossil fuels already kills at least 8 million people every year. By 2100, another 1 billion lives will have been cut short. Damage to the economy will add up to more than 5% of GDP. Compare climate change and air pollution to other global issues, and they already rank in the top 3 of major world problems. Continue burning fossil fuels and climate change quickly takes the top spot, before spilling over into nearly every other human problem. But many argue that the forecast needn't look so bleak. Humanity won't just sit back and let rising temperatures destroy prosperity. If GDP grows at just half the rate of the last 40 years, the average annual income will more than triple to over $70,000 per person by the end of this century. Why can't future generations simply spend their way out of the problem? The reason is unmanageable change. Experts know that dangerous tipping points exist, which could lead to complete global systemic breakdown. The acceleration of melting ice, biosphere feedback, a financial carbon crunch, or conflict could trigger a tipping point moment. Climate change may become unmanageable, no matter how much money is thrown at it. With further temperature increases locked in, we know further adaptation will be necessary. But other tactics must be deployed if we are to avoid dangerous tipping points. Climate engineering could seem the easy, cheap option, limiting the sun's incoming energy. Using space mirrors, aerosols, or cloud whitening might keep temperatures at bay. But such measures don't solve air pollution or ocean acidification and run a seriously high risk of going wrong. Negative emissions technologies to remove CO2 from the atmosphere are lower risk but more expensive, or can only cover a fraction of emissions. Mitigation of carbon dioxide and the transition to a net zero carbon economy offers the only complete and low-risk solution. Systems thinking to build net zero. If we are to reach net zero, greenhouse gas emissions from human activities must be eliminated where possible, and where not, they must be drawn down from the atmosphere to offset any residual emissions. Greenhouse gases are the product of population, consumption, energy efficiency, and emissions intensity. So which is the best road to net zero? The answer is all four, but not in equal measure. Attempting to control human reproduction is slow and morally difficult, and the global population should self-limit with growing wealth. Consumption limits are effective, but demand a complete rewiring of socioeconomic behaviors and are best left to activities with little other option. Energy efficiency buys time, but never offers a complete solution. The bulk of the change must come from slashing emissions intensity and reaching net zero. Wind and solar electricity, coupled with pumped hydro and battery storage, can form the backbone of a net zero economy, providing cost-competitive, safe, reliable energy with no carbon emissions or air pollution. We must electrify our energy demand wherever possible, and where not, switch to hydrogen, biofuels, or carbon capture. Electrification will replace oil-powered transport, gas-powered heating, and coal-powered industry. Global agriculture must modernize to cut waste and lower carbon intensity, whilst much of the world must cut back on meat consumption to free up enough agricultural land to regrow forests. Change will be all-encompassing, but requires no compromise on quality of life, simply the breaking of old habits. The transition will barely register for the richest 10% of the global population. The poorest 10% will, for the first time, connect to the modern world with electricity access, clean cooking, and basic amenities. A just and equitable transition for all. Electrification of demand brings large efficiency gains. Heat pumps use 4 times less energy than gas boilers. Electric cars 3 times less energy than combustion engines. A net zero economy will demand less than half the energy of the equivalent fossil fuel systems, with no compromise on travel, goods, food or amenities. The whole system will end up 25% cheaper to buy and run than the fossil fuel alternative. Wind, solar, and battery costs are already shrinking by 10 to 35% every time the number of installations doubles. It's not the passing of time that lowers costs, but the scale of production. Sitting on our hands and waiting for a breakthrough is not the way forward. The faster we push, the sooner we create a cheaper energy system. We avoid worst-case climate outcomes. We save nearly 8 million deaths per year from air pollution. And we create more jobs by directing our energy spending into labor rather than exorbitant profits for petrostates. A net zero world would be cheaper to run, cleaner, safer, more reliable, more sustainable, and create more employment than a world bound to fossil fuels. We can avert disaster and drive greater human prosperity. Financing a net zero transition. A net zero economy will be cheaper, cleaner, and safer. And this makes net zero inevitable. But that doesn't mean the speed of the transition can't be optimized. Continuing to run a fossil fuel economy is inefficient, and just like any other market inefficiency, it can be corrected to drive greater prosperity. Think about the value investor Warren Buffett, who buys companies trading below their intrinsic value, or Silicon Valley venture capital firms, who recognize the potential of tech enthusiasts running makeshift operations from their parents' garages. These market players profit from inefficiencies, and in doing so, they also correct them. Warren Buffett's undervalued investment portfolio appreciates, and Apple, Google, and Amazon are born. In the same way, markets will undoubtedly move towards net zero as the best solution. However, by providing an early helping hand to overcome market inefficiencies, the speed of the transition can be optimized, generating greater wealth, improving health, and accelerating prosperity. Getting to net zero will require $70 trillion of upfront investment, $46 trillion more than remaining with fossil fuels. But it will create an energy system more than $5.5 trillion cheaper to run each year. A 20-year transition provides the best balance, with enough time for governments, businesses, and individuals to adjust, whilst bringing the system cost savings forward and more than offsetting any losses from stranded fossil fuel assets or from crowding out other investments. Over the next two decades, we install just four solar panels, plant 27 trees, and develop 16 square meters of third-generation biofuel cultivation for each person on the planet. We add the equivalent of one radiator-sized battery in every house and just one wind turbine between every 7,000 people. Partway through the transition, we decide whether renewables can cost-competitively carry us all the way to net zero, or whether support from next-generation nuclear or fossil fuels with carbon capture is needed. Either way, the best course of action for the next decade is abundantly clear. Push as hard as possible on wind and solar and electrify everything. Supply must be deployed 5 times faster and demand switched nearly 10 times quicker to reach an optimal outcome. The world already invests $1.75 trillion in mostly fossil fuel energy each year and another $0.5 trillion on fossil fuel subsidies. We need to redirect this money and find another $1.25 trillion per year, 1.5% of GDP, to deploy in net zero solutions at a competitive market rate of return. The money is ready and waiting to go. It just needs clear direction from governments and private savers. Net zero financing will create new and productive investment opportunities, boost jobs, and stimulate the economy while creating a cheaper energy system with a 10-year payback. Bridging the climate divide to achieve net zero. Despite the abundant benefits of reaching net zero, progress so far has been slow. Since the International Panel on Climate Change formed in 1990, we have emitted as much CO2 into the atmosphere as all human history before. The hurdles to action range from apathy, misaligned economic interests, inequality, and free riding, to deliberate sabotage. Each and all has slowed progress. But the longer we wait, the bigger and more immediate the threat becomes. The more people die from air pollution, and our window of opportunity for the best outcome will inevitably narrow. The time has come for governments around the globe, corporates, and individuals to stop stalling and to push towards a better system. Awareness and willingness to act are certainly on the rise. The unified scientific voice grows louder. 26 countries have declared a climate crisis, and protests across the globe are mobilizing young and old alike. Over 100 countries around the world, covering over half of all emissions, have made net zero pledges for the middle of this century. However, today's average world leader will be nearly 100 years old when those targets come due. Translating long-term pledges into action is crucial. We must create change, not just talk about it. Individuals can electrify end uses and source zero carbon electricity, forcing demand away from fossil fuels. Vote with your ballot paper and your wallet. Choose credible policy and low-carbon products. Politicians will soon respond to the changing polls, and companies will soon react to falling revenues. Cut back on meat. The average diet requires one football pitch of agricultural land, whereas the vegan equivalent requires just the penalty box. Reduce consumption where you can, but this should remain a personal choice. We must avoid the idea that solving climate change requires hardship. Net zero is not a zero-sum game, but a win-win, and we have everything needed to transition without compromise. Corporates should strive for net zero as the best sustainable economic outcome. Greenwashing should not be used as a marketing tool. Politics should be used to transition the energy system. Climate change should not be used as an excuse to change politics. Once we understand that a net zero system will create a more favorable outcome for both right and left politics, big and small business, the individual and society, then we can accelerate change for the better. Net zero will be cheaper, cleaner, safer, more reliable, more sustainable, and will create more employment than if we remain bound to fossil fuels. By understanding and acting on this statement, we can redefine the argument and create a better future for all on planet Earth. To find out more, visit www.net-zero.blog.